Welcome to the Rabbitohs Top 4 Podcast, proudly presented by What If, official travel and pathways partner of the South Sydney Rabbitohs. Here are your hosts, Mark Ellison, Shannon Donato, and Jeremy Monahan.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Rabbitohs Top 4 Podcast, powered by Audio Technica and proudly presented by What If. What If has you covered for accommodation, flights, car hire and more. So if you're looking for a holiday, travelling for business, or you need to get to the next game, visit whatif.com/Rabbitohs. What If, it's Aussie for travel. My name's Jeremy Monahan. I'm the media manager here at the South Sydney Rabbitohs, and I'd like to welcome my co-host Mark Ellison and Shannon Donato. How are you, hello?
Very well, Jez. How are you, mate?
I'm well.
What week are we up to now for
this? This is episode number 14.
Yeah, I thought you'd be able to memorise the introduction by now, mate. You've read it. I think I brought it up in episode 2, but let's try and work on that, Jess.
All right,
you're doing a great job. I love the dulcet tones.
I'll work on it for next week. Let's hope I remember they're called What If.
Maybe you could do it next week. Yeah.
Look, I've got enough work on this show as it is, Shannon.
Very good. How are you, Shannon?
I'm really well, thank you, Jerry. After a great weekend in Dubbo, the result, of course, wasn't what we wanted, but engaging with the community out there was fantastically successful for the entire club and the Rabbitohs family.
Beautiful. Well, let's get stuck into it. What's something that you've learnt this week? We'll start with you, Shannon.
I've learnt that losing isn't much fun. Mm. We were 8-2, and you know, I think we were travelling really, really well. We'd had one hiccup, one team against the Storm, but besides that, we hadn't lost any other games besides to the Storm, and you know, we're going really well. But maybe it's just a, you know, reality check for the team and recalibration. And the good thing is, it's only, you know, we're in the first half of the year, so still got a long way to go before the whips start cracking and get into the real competition. But yeah, losing in such a way to the Panthers wasn't much fun.
No, not at all. What about you, Ella? Yeah, what did you learn this
I'd
week?
I'd agree with that, with Shannon, what you said about the losing. What I've learned is that, you know, everyone within the organisation has sort of sat back and had a look at it. And one of my takes on it is that I've learned how important having a consistent playing group on the field week in, week out makes to your performance. And I mean, you look at Penrith, I mean, they haven't had many injury. They had one or two changes on the weekend, but not holus bolus changes. Like, you make one or two changes, you can get by. I'm coming back from a positive point of view on our performances so far. Our spine hasn't played together for 4 weeks. Cody Walker has played fullback the last 4 weeks. There was no Luttrell. So Cody comes back in the first line. There's been no Cameron Murray for three. Campbell Graham's come back for his first game. Josh Mansour came in for his first game. I'm not making excuses, but I'm just saying once we get our team out there and we can get a run without having to change it, you know, most weeks we've been changing our team lately. So if I asked any of our viewers, any of our listeners, not viewers, any listeners or anyone within the club, you know, if we'd be happy with 8-3 at this stage of the year, when the first ball was kicked off, we'd say yes, we would be. Mm. There's a gap between Penrith and the rest at the moment, and you know, everyone's aware of that. But it's only May. Mm. There's an Origin series to come where they'll lose some of their players, and we just need that little bit of luck with injuries and things like that, so we can get our team back together, mm, playing together the same 17 for a nice run of 5 or 6 weeks, mm, and we'll see the Rabbitohs. And mm, I love the fact that the media is writing us off, and we know they come at us. They come at us, you know, when they think we're down, they want to put the slipper in, but that's okay.
Yeah.
That's okay. We've seen all that before, and it doesn't bother us really. If anything, it ignites us. Mm. So that's what I've learned. We need to get our best team on the field as much as possible, and if we're making changes, we have one or two here and there rather than have to make, you know, holus bolus changes. Mm. as a result of certain things.
Hello. Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I think you'd rather have our core together for the 6 weeks leading into the final than the first 6 weeks of the season. So if you're ever going to have this disruption and this sort of little bit of inconsistency, you'd rather it now. You know, the one thing I know about Wayne Bennett coach sides, having seen them for 25 years, is they're always peaking going into the finals. I can remember years gone by when we've started the year really well, and then falling away. Well, I'd rather go the other way, and I'm confident that's what we'll do.
Yeah, go on.
I remember in Wayne's first year with us, he came out and he said, in his view, the 24 or 25 rounds of the season are all the practice rounds to get things right. And he said, you just got to make sure that you collect enough wins to qualify at the end of the year. And then it's those 4 weeks that really, really matter. And as you say, you'd rather have all the trips and the stumbles now than you would in those last few weeks leading into those finals, which could put you on a bit of an unsteady step going into those last 4 weeks. I was saying to someone the other day that Penrith and probably Melbourne are a level ahead of everyone else at the moment, but if you can turn in 4 good weeks at the end of the year, you win the comp.
Spot on. And you look at Penrith last year. They were the benchmark last year, of course, but they stumbled at the wrong time of year.
Yeah.
They got stage fright on grand final night, the most important game.
Nearly didn't make grand final night.
Yeah, that's right.
We were 2 inches of a 40-20 away from beating them.
If Adam Reynolds cuts his toenails on that game, he probably gets the 40-20.
If he wore the size 8s instead of the size 9s.
I spoke to him about that too, Shane. No, you're right.
Hygiene's important, Adam. Cut those toenails.
Anyone that knows anything about rugby league knows you need to be in the top four.
Yeah.
And that's the goal. We're in the top four at the moment.
Yep.
Sure. Our performance was poor on the weekend. We know that. But, you know, internally we know there's probably a few reasons for it. The players had a great review yesterday with the coaching staff. Very honest. And not a crisis meeting like that people report. I mean, it's just how are we going to get better? What are we going to do to make sure we're back to our best? And the wheels are in motion now. And I'm sure you'll see a fantastic performance on Saturday night. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, Bring on the Eels. Bring on the Eels.
Me too. Couple of things this week. One that I didn't learn this week, but I wanted to mention. And then another thing where I have learnt quite a bit this week being Indigenous around. I'll mention the first one first is just a reminder on the weekend of how good a bloke Kyle Turner is. So he was out there working with South Cares. He's obviously not directly connected with the club anymore, but gave up his own time to go out to schools and community visits, coaching clinics, all sorts of things. South Cares saw over 3,000 kids out in Dubbo over 5 days leading up to the game. Phenomenal effort, and Big Dog was part of that. And then on game day, he did an interview with me on field. He was part of our kicking competition at halftime. He was shaking everyone's hand, signing autographs and all of this. And he's won a competition for this club. Like, he's one of the modern day legends of this club for what he achieved with that team in 2014. And there's no airs, no graces about him. He's a country boy. He's so happy living back in Coonabarabra, and he's building his life with his partner and his child. And it's just an absolute credit to him how much he still loves the club. And you could see he was a bit itchy when I was interviewing him. The boys were warming up behind him, and you could see he was a bit itchy being back amongst them. And just an absolute champion bloke.
Yeah, the unsung hero of our 2014 premiership. You know, Kyle Turner just did all the mopping up and the tidying up around the middle of the field. And you know, that doesn't surprise me, Jez, on his attitude on game day at Dubbo. You know, he loves it out there. He loves the Rabbitohs. He understands the importance of kids and grassroots level in rugby league. And I saw him in the dressing room after the game. He said, "Can you believe how hard Jez has worked me out here?"
he was quite reluctant to go into the shed. He said, "I don't want to be one of those blokes that hangs around." I said, "Mate, please go in there and put a smile on a few of those blokes' faces to see you, because they're feeling like rubbish at the moment. I think a few of them would really appreciate seeing you in there, mate." And he went in. So I'm glad he went in and saw a few of his old teammates that he held the trophy with.
Yeah, well said, Jez. Yeah. I think, you know, obviously tough loss, but he is. He's a thoroughly decent fella, Kyle. And, you know, I'm feeling your love for him too, because just seeing his work out there, the whole community love him down there. down there. He's actually from outside of town, Coonabarra Brand, but spends a bit of time in Dubbo, well known and well respected, and obviously still well loved by the Rabbitohs.
Yeah, absolutely.
Tremendous person.
Yeah.
And, yeah, he's going to be a great family man. I know he's, you know, he just started the family off, but he'll be just as good as that as he is at everything else.
Absolutely. Then the other thing that I did learn a lot about this week, it is Indigenous round this week, and one of the things that I've said before how much I've learnt from our Indigenous players and the people in South Cairns about the Indigenous culture, because I was never taught any of it at school, and I've grown a real appreciation for it over probably the last decade or so talking to these guys. And this week with Indigenous Round, they're highlighting a lot of the statistics around Indigenous people and some of the numbers that are coming out. So 3% of Australians have an Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander background, yet they represent 12% of NRL players. What an achievement for those people to be four times the amount of ratio of people that are in the population to representing themselves in the NRL. It's phenomenal achievement for those people.
So if you're Aboriginal, you're 400% more likely to be making the NRL
than
an Aboriginal person. And we've seen, you know, you see blokes like Latrell and Cody, and you can see why, just sublime, naturally gifted athletes, and, you know, they're a great addition to the NRL. In fact, they're not an addition, they're an integral part of the NRL.
Yeah. And I think it's significant today we're talking about, you know, one of the topics, I don't want to get ahead of us, but it's the top Indigenous players of all time. And the big thing when you're talking about the greatest or the top, they always have things that they can do that other people can't do.
Yeah.
And many Indigenous players, no matter if they're the best Indigenous players or they're just normal Indigenous players in NRL, have things that no other player can do.
Yeah.
They have an innate skill set to them. You know, they have a remarkable ability to know where the football is going to be. And you know,
self-confidence too.
Yeah,
you know,
and it goes back to the sort of backyard football we all talk about.
Yeah.
They that's how they play, and when that's on, they're the best to watch.
Yeah, absolutely. Some of the other stats, I was particularly talking to Cody Walker about it. Indigenous people have an expected lifespan 8 years shorter than non-Indigenous people in terms of health outcomes, and he was saying it's just a fact that Aboriginal people need to look after themselves better, or they're not going to live as long and as healthy a life as non-Indigenous people. It's just a fact of their genetic makeup that's how it is. So they need that support to be able to live the same lives that other non-Indigenous Australians have. 26% unemployment rate amongst Indigenous people greater than non-Indigenous people, which just blows me away. Like, we're all people. We're all capable of doing jobs and playing a role in society, and it's obvious that Indigenous people aren't getting the opportunities that other people are.
Yes. Sadly, Jez, some of these deficits in terms of numbers of, you know, health outcomes and other areas, one leads into the other, the other. So, you know, the completion rates of Aboriginal kids, sadly, are much lower than non-Aboriginal kids. So then, obviously, that affects their employment and their employability, which then affects their health.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's why it's incumbent on all of us to try and 100%. right the wrongs.
One of the scariest ones, and I don't know the exact numbers, so I don't want to say it, but was suicide rates in kids. Is something like a third or something like that of all young kids that Aboriginal kids that pass away is from suicide.
It's
just
tragic,
frightening.
It is. Absolutely, it is tragic. I've got some Aboriginal friends, including Alicia at South Cares, the general manager, and I hear her use the expression of trying to walk in both worlds.
Yeah,
you know, they've some Aboriginal families, particularly in the regional communities, are brought up strongly with culture, and some aren't, and some are trying to walk in both worlds. They're expected to, you know, be authentic and true to their culture, but then they're expected to, you know, you know, live to the white man's norms as well. And it must be really, those kids, particularly at your teenage years when you're trying to find your sense of identity, that must be really, really difficult for them, confusing for them. And unfortunately, we're losing way too many of them.
And as I've said, I've never lived in that world. I've never lived in a world of prejudice or not having advantages that other people do. So I find it really hard to relate to it, but I'm just stunned by some of those numbers. And I hope other people are too, that it shocks them into wanting to know more about it and how they can help it. And one of the points I made to Cody this week, because he's one of the spokespeople for Indigenous players amongst the game, I said to him, when you're talking to the media, I said, I'd be saying something like, it's fantastic that the NRL does this every year, that it highlights all these things in Indigenous round for that week a year, but we need to be thinking about it and actioning it 52 weeks a year.
Not
just the one week. And now we can highlight it this week because everyone's got the attention on the Indigenous society and Indigenous players within the NRL. And I know the NBL have got their Indigenous round this week. And we're actually recording on Wednesday, which is the National Sorry Day. So there's all these highlighted events during the week, but it needs to be a 52-week a year exercise and thought process to turn these things around. It can't be done in one 52nd of a year.
That's
one
right.
One week a year.
And I'm proud to say our club, through the work we do with South Cares, is doing that. They're working with Indigenous kids to make sure they finish their HSC. You know, we've got the NCAP program, the New Careers for Aboriginal People, helped over the last 3 years, help 400 long-term unemployed Aboriginal people into employment. And as I said, that affects their health and everything else. That's transformational for those families. For 400 families who have been affected by long-term unemployment, to be helped into employment, that changes the outcome for not only that person who's employed, but their entire family and those in the orbit around them. So I'm really proud of the fact that South Cares are doing that year-round, day in, day out, doing fantastic work supporting the Indigenous community. But as you said, this round is a chance to highlight those deficits and make us all reflect upon what we can do and how we can do it better.
And as hopefully inspire society. People to take action.
The highlighting it is great, which we do, and we are doing, you know, through South Cares, you know, actioning things to improve it. And, you know, it's for higher authorities than us to be to making sure this happens. And, you know, obviously there's help out there for, you know, for people, you know, the organisations who want to get involved. So, you're quite right, Jez, because it's something that needs improving.
Yeah, and big time.
It's not going to change, just as you say, by 1 week a year. It's something that needs to be done consistently, and people need to be persistent in their approach to it.
That's it. What a serious start to the show today, gents.
I know, we've been speaking football.
All right, let's get onto our first topic. And as prefaced earlier by Ello, it's the top four Indigenous players that you've seen or played with over the years. We'll start with you, Ello.
I'm not going to go about players I've played with because I've mentioned some of them before in Paul Roberts. He was probably one of the best Indigenous players I played with the, you know, the array of skill he had. And to be fair with Paul, he was quite a sizable lad for an Indigenous player, particularly back when we played in the 80s and 90s. But, you know, going away from that, I think I have to say Greg Inglis is the greatest Indigenous player that I've ever seen. And when we say greatest, I know that's not the term, but I'm going to say greatest. Greatest to me is players that can do things that are outside the norm.
Yeah.
You know, and we've spoken about it before with the tries he scored, the one in the centenary test, but Greg had an amazing ability to when he was playing fullback for us, to run the ball back. No one could stop him.
Yeah.
No one could stop. Well, they might stop him, but then he'd just push them off like flies to get up and play the ball. And if they're hanging on, he'd get a penalty for us. Now, and his penalties weren't milked. They were gained.
Yeah.
You know, and that was an enormous advantage that we had in that era, having Greg do that. And we've spoken about his defence before, you know, his cross over palm. But the other thing, Greg Inglis in the open, watching him run, you know, if anyone in the game gets people to stand up and get off their seat when he's in the clear, he was one of the greatest of all time that I've ever seen. And, you know, we were just so fortunate to have him at our club.
Yeah.
In his prime.
Yeah.
And a lovely guy. A lovely guy to go with it.
Yeah.
Which always helps. You know, as we say in our game, we don't meet many guys that...
No.
No good, but he was one of the gentlemen of the game that I knew.
One of the things with Greggy too, we talk about, always talk about the tries he scored and everything that he did with the ball in hand or making tackles. But towards the end of his career too, when he was struggling a bit with his injuries and ageing, he became the greatest decoy runner in the comp.
Well,
he did because
he made a career of doing that.
He would attract, when he'd loop out to that left-hand side, he'd attract four defenders on his own. Like, I don't want to disrespect someone like Darius Boyd, but Darius Boyd's career was made on Greg Inglis. Like, GI is the number one origin try scorer, and I think number two is Darius Boyd, all down the left-hand edge of for Queensland, where Greg would either give the offload to Darius or the ball would go behind GI after he's attracted three or four defenders. Yep. And it's the same with anyone that's played left wing for us. Alex Johnston, great finisher, scored 112 or something, 115 tries in his career, and I think he owes a lot of those to GI and what he was doing on the inside. Robert Jennings, when he was playing with us, I think was equal top try scorer or missed out by one try playing on our left wing.
Yep.
When AJ was out injured, and just that left wing spot for South is like gold.
Yeah.
Well, as you say, you sum Greg Inglis up. He had the strength of a middle forward.
Yeah.
He had the pass of a halfback.
Yeah. And won a Clive Churchill medal at 5'8". He was the Dalian 5'8".
And
he
had the speed of an Olympic...
Yeah.
Sprinter.
Yeah.
And he had the decoy running skills of Mark Ellis.
Yeah, there you go.
Ellis used to sell more dummies than a chemist.
He was selling them, you were spitting them.
Very true. Yeah, I just had to bring some humour back. We're getting too deep here, guys. Remember what this show's all about.
That's it. That's it.
So, yeah, so Greg's a one, another one for me. I've mentioned before, Arthur Beetson.
Yeah.
I was only a kid watching him play, but he was a different front rower than most. You know, at his prime, he was quick. He used to be a centre, I think, when he first came into grade football. He had offloading skill. He had, he was quick for his size. But the best thing you could see, I didn't know, I was only a kid, but you look back, he was a leader. He was a leader of men, you know, and, in his culture, he's obviously been a leader. And, you know, you speak, even after the game when he got involved in recruitment and that for the Roosters and he coached at the Sharks and things like that.
Yep.
He just had a remarkable personality and talent to be able to, people would gravitate towards him. And, that was a great sign of a great man. And he was doing things in the game as a front row before others did them.
Hello, can I say, and I don't want to embarrass you, but a lot of similar traits in that he was a skillful forward when it wasn't that popular post-football. He went into sort of recruitment and managing operational side of football. But I think what you both most have in common is your love of pies, actually. I reckon I can see a lot of Artie Beats near you, so I can see why you nominated him as one of your top ones. Well done.
Very good.
I like that.
Very
good.
I'm
just going to let the mat up today, Shannon. I'll come with a late barrage and just destroy you.
Very good.
Yeah, but a great... another player who I played against, and Cliff Lyons was just probably the type of player that I love watching, because I liked, as you said, bit of skill. I used to like playing with skill, and that he had the light. He you talk about Greg Inglis making Darius Boyd. I mean, Cliff Lyons went a long way to making the Beaver Menzies career as well. But not taking nothing away from the Beaver. He'd be the first one to tell you. He was a great player also, but Cliff Lyons just had the skill. He could bob up anywhere, and he had that sense of backyard football, playing what was in front of him. He didn't need the structures and that. He'd play all over the field. There was no left or right for Cliff Lyons.
Yep.
You know, he played wherever he wanted and wherever the football was. And it goes back to, God bless his soul, the great Bob Fulton was his coach when he was playing there. And, what a loss to the game, a loss to his family, this week. But Cliffy was coached by Bozo for much of his career. And it's a credit to Bozo that he could see that in a time where the game was becoming very structured.
Yes.
That he just let Cliffy And that's why they were so hard to beat.
Yeah.
Because they weren't doing what everyone else was doing. They were just playing their own brand of football, which was great to watch.
Hello, yeah. You know, we've spoken about so many of those great Aboriginal traits as players that they've got, and Cliffy Lyons had all of those, the instinct, the heads up, skillful football. But one of the things that's relatively common with Aboriginal players is the longevity of their career, yes. how old they can play to. And like Cliffy played until he's 64, and that was amazing.
I think he's still playing.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised. Like, he was seriously playing in his mid to late 40s in the A-grade competition. Yeah. Still may be. And, you know, even he was playing great NRL footy well into his 30s.
Mm.
And the reason he does it, because of his love of the game.
Yeah.
And his ability to, you know, to keep producing on the big stage. And he was just, he used to deceive opposition, you know, defences.
Do you see similarities between Cliff Lyons and Cody Walker?
I do in some ways.
Yeah.
Cody, I think Cliff created more for others, whereas Cody can do that, but Cody creates for himself probably in a different way than Cliff could. Maybe Cody's just slightly quicker.
Yeah.
You know?
Doesn't smoke as many bungers at half time.
Paddy and Selma don't smoke as many bungers at half time as Cliffy Lyons.
I must say, defence was different back then when Cliffy was playing that.
Yeah.
So the defence wasn't as well drilled as what it is now. So for Cody to be able to make his own way through defences like he does, that's something I think that is unique to Cody.
Mm.
They have a lot of, you know, just that drifting across field and dummy and just Cody's a great deceiver too, you know, of defences and that. But, I see similarities, but I think their greatest attributes, they're slightly different.
Yep.
One of the great things I love about Cody's game is his first instinct is always to take the line on himself.
Mm.
And then what will happen is if they come in and clump in on him, that creates the opportunity for someone else. And I remember an old coach of ours, he coached here at the Rabbitohs, John Lang, saying, if that's your first instinct, it'll always be your right one, because the instinct to pass when you have three defenders on you will just come to you naturally.
Mm.
But take on the line, and Cody's got that in spades. Mm. And that's why he creates so many opportunities for himself, but they also open up for his colleagues.
Yeah, and he makes a lot of those opportunities for himself happen.
Yes.
A bit, unlike you when you used to get out of dummy half, look for something and then go, oh, shit, and the front row. All the front, you ever see the front rows that played with Shannon?
Yeah.
Broken noses, broken jaws, teeth missing. Oh, there's nothing for me.
Hey, don't worry about that. Speaking about broken jaws and chipped teeth, you keep going.
I thought this was a family show.
Yes, just did I.
Hey, he can only take so much.
He's a bit feisty this morning. He hasn't had his four bacon and egg rolls yet. That's why.
Only one short.
Yeah. I'm angry.
He's angry.
The last one for me, and I think Jonathan Thurston.
Yeah.
Just had all the skills.
Yeah.
Plus, he was a goal kicker on top of that, which is an extra string to his bow. But.
Mm.
You look at all those players and you have a look how significant they were in their eras at their clubs.
Mm.
How they were the players that, you know, every team has a player that if he's not playing, their win percentage goes down.
Yeah.
Those players, Greg Inglis, Arthur Beetson, Cliff Lyons and Jonathan Thurston, all had that about them.
Yeah.
If they didn't play, the odds of their team winning diminished remarkably. Not just a little bit, but a lot.
Yeah.
Ironically, the teams I played in, I had the exact opposite effect. So when I got named
every week.
He's banging
himself now, Chester. Oh, right. I'm going to stop
that
now.
Just sounded like fun with you two. I thought I'd jump in.
If you can't beat them, join them, Shannon.
Yeah, so they're my four.
Excellent. Four excellent players.
I'm disappointed we didn't get you six players as usual.
Well, right. I told you about Paul Roberts, but I've never mentioned him before.
The great man. Jess, why don't we go with you? Because, you're a great student of the game. You've been very close to the game for a long time. So let's hear yours.
So it was mean you haven't done any research this week?
Correct.
I only had a couple different, to LA, just some different ideas. One was David Peachy. The way he used to glide across the ground with those long limbs, everyone else would take three or four paces to cover 10 metres. He'd take one, maybe two. He'd just be bounding up the field, and the big swerve that he had on him, it was just beautiful to watch. And seeing him in full flight was similar to seeing Greggy in full flight, even though they had different running styles. It was just beautiful to watch him take off, and a lot of that was mainly when he was playing at the Sharks, but geez, it was a pleasure to work with him here at the Rabbitohs, and he was someone that I bumped into at Dubbo.
Oh, did you?
On the weekend, yeah.
Yeah, I saw him out there too.
But well, at the game?
Yeah, at the game. And I tell you what, the smile was back. He was beaming. Yeah. He was just so happy to be there, and everyone was there getting autographs and photos of him, and I thought, that's the peach. That's the peach right there. It was great to see
him. I was fortunate to be the assistant coach here when Peach played, and you know, we were a team that was really struggling and trying to rebuild, and he brought back a professionalism to the club that wasn't there at that stage, like getting players to do extras after training. When training used to finish, the boys would go off because they thought, oh, we're done, you know, and some of them weren't aspiring to get too much better, unfortunately, because that's where we were at that stage. Mm. But Peach got them back out on the field and used to work on their little skills together and stuff like that. And, you know, it was no coincidence that, you know, we made the first playoff series that South had made since 89 with David Peachy being back there.
Yeah, that's true. That's true, yeah. Beautiful player and a champion fella. And I was so happy to see him there on Sunday at Dubbo. Another one that I had, one of the current day players, Latrell Mitchell. So I've spoken about it before. He's a triple threat with his speed, his power and his skill. And he gets so many comparisons, particularly in the media, to GI, I think because they're both Indigenous footballers with similar powerful builds and playing the same position. But I've said it before, I see so much of John Sutton in Latrell. And I'm sure a lot of what Sutto does at training with him is rubbing off on Latrell, because I used to call Sutton the magician. Some of the things he could do with the ball in his hands were just amazing, and you can see that with Latrell now. That's a real part of his game, and it's so good to see him so happy. He's really settled at the club. He's got his family around him. Yesterday, saw him in here, and the boys were doing a signing session for sponsors' jerseys, and he was up there with his daughter, and he was pointing out the different names on the jersey and all that sort of stuff, and it's just, he's a great family man, he's a great fella, and he's got all of his best football in front of him. He's 23 years of age.
Amazing.
I was about to say that, Jez. I was going to put him in, and I left him out for that reason. I thought he has the potential to be the best of them all.
Yeah.
You know, he's 23, he's enjoying the game and loving it.
Yeah.
He's an incredible competitor. He knows what he wants to do in his life. Mm. He knows what he expects out of rugby league.
Yeah.
And he has the ability to be the best of all, I think.
What about on the weekend out in Dubbo? We'd been beaten by near on 50 points. Everyone was so disappointed. He spent nearly an hour walking around the fence, signing autographs and getting photos with the locals. Being a country boy himself, he understood how important it was to make sure you interact with the fans of the game. And we actually had to go out and almost literally dragging back inside, because we had to get, well, half the squad had to get on a plane. We had to get moving.
Yes.
So we actually had to bring him in, and he was not upset, but he sort of felt like he'd let people down, that he hadn't got around to everybody around the fence. And it's just, that's the sort of bloke he is.
He is. He does that everywhere he goes. Yeah. He's just always so generous with his time, and he knows what it means to kids, and not just kids, but just fans and lovers of rugby league, and particularly the Rabbitohs. He's such a great ambassador for our game. People talk about him being an ambassador and a spokesman for Aboriginal people. He might be, and he is, and he does a good job of that, but he's a great ambassador for our game.
Yeah.
He just, you know, always thinking of the supporters and giving back.
Yeah. Over to you, Shannon.
Okay. Well, my first one is a walk down memory lane. I don't know whether LA coached this guy, but he's one of the most naturally gifted footballers I've ever seen. And no, I'm not talking about myself. Although I could have been. I'm talking about Lee Hookey.
You're also Italian, not Aboriginal.
Right, that's right. Yes, very true.
I coached Lee Hookey in the Junior Bunnies. He's first ever team he played for at the Rabbitohs. And in that team was Willie Peters.
Yes.
Craig Wing.
Yes.
There's obviously Lee. There was a good little team.
Did you win it?
Oh, was Ali played three? You played against three different clubs.
Okay.
But we went down to Illawarra one night and played.
So that's a no, Jez. By
yeah,
the way.
That's right. Yeah.
No, we won our.
Thanks
we did
for the direct
won,
answer to a direct question.
We won our three games.
Oh, okay.
You know, and as you know, Shannon, if you know anything about rugby league,
you're speaking to the wrong bloke, hello.
At 14 years of age, Shannon, it's more about development than yes. just winning. Okay,
yes. We'll see. But Shannon, we did win the three games.
No,
right?
Shannon was still playing in the under-11s when he was 14. So.
Yeah. Anyway, back to your story, LA.
You anyway, yeah, so went down to Illawarra and played against a team that had Jason Ryle, Sean Tibbins, Matthew Head, and yep. players like that. So it was a really good test for them. They won well, and he had remarkable skill.
Yes,
well, he had just a natural body swerve.
Yes.
I don't know how to explain it, but yeah. Anyway,
like a shimmy.
You talk more, shimmy with footwork.
He could step off both feet. He also had a good fend. Not unlike a Latrell build when he was younger. He was just a naturally gifted footballer. South Juniors through and through, out of the streets of Waterloo and Redfern, and. Unfortunately, I don't think he lived up to his full potential. Like, I honestly think he was good enough to one day have played for Australia and Origin, but played lots of first grade and played very well. So, Leo Hookey is one of my players.
He used to call me Deep End, was his nickname for him, because he said whenever I asked him to do media interviews, I was throwing him in the deep end.
Actually, that's quite nice for some of the members of
Well, I think it was Deep End. It sounded like Deep End.
That's nice of the names I call you, I can tell you, Jess. All right. I'll keep it civil. Leo Hookey is my first. My second is another guy who played here at the Rabbitohs, played at a couple of clubs. It's a great Reece Wester. Still here doing great work for South Cares, of course, but the explosive speed. I've never seen anybody with explosive. People talk about Steve Renoff and those guys, and they were all fast, but just from 0 to 100, and we talk about Jimmy the Jet now. I would like to see Jimmy the Jet against Reece in his prime. I just remember there'd be just half a gap, someone passing the ball, bang, he'd be through it, and they just wouldn't even get a hand to him. He was that quick, and once he got into open space, I used to go back and get ready for the kickoff because I knew it was a try, and also because I was too lazy to chase and support. But, you know, Reece Wester was just an excitement machine, and as I said, still doing great work for South Cares and still a fantastic fella.
I've got a funny story about Reece. I think I may have told it before, but for those that haven't been listening since the start, so we used to have a touch footy team in the office where we'd go and play down at Queen's Park on like a Tuesday or a Wednesday night or something, and Reece agreed to play, and we're all so excited. We're thinking, we're not going to get beat here. So we actually called the team Get the Ball to Reece.
Yes.
That was the name of the team, Get the Ball to Reece. Yes. He turned up for one game. But I remember the fear in the opposition's eyes when they noticed Reece Wester, because he wasn't long retired then.
Yeah. Even now, he's still in great nick, isn't he?
He's in great nick now.
Yeah.
He's lost a bit of weight lately. He's been making concerted effort to get back into his training, and he's looking... $1 million. I'm going to say $100. $1 million.
Yeah, right.
But he played one game in the team named after him, and it was 7-7 going into the last couple of minutes, and I was absolutely buggered in this game because I think we might have had one female reserve, so there were no male reserves. So I was in my usual position out on the wing, bludging out on the wing. Reece took off up the middle of the field, and I could see the gap open up in front of him, and I thought, oh, is anyone going to go with him? So I've just run as fast as I can, and Reece's thrown the big left-to-right pass out to me. I had no one in front of me, and unfortunately, Reece didn't realise that I wasn't as quick as Reece. And it sailed past my fingertips out in front of me. 7-7 finish. Imagine that story. Winning a game off Reece Wester pass. I could have told it forever. Now I'm telling about it in my failures.
You talk about that.
That's the highlight of your career.
You talk about the fear in the opposition eyes when he came turn up to play. The only thing greater than the fear was the fear the next week in your eyes when he didn't turn up to play.
I thought you were going to say the 50-kilo girl defending opposite me when I was out on the wing playing like Brett Plowman or Ross Harrington, one of the big wingers.
So it was obviously a mixed team.
It was a mixed team, yes, a mixed
That's
team.
That's why Jez got to play with the men.
Yeah.
All righty. So we've got Lee.
Do we need to talk about Shannon's efforts in touch football teams at work?
No, we don't.
Torn hammies in one game.
Hang on.
on the same week.
You blokes are hard. Where's Jan Earl? I need some personal self-esteem.
She doesn't like you either, mate. Oh, that's confidential.
I was going to ring my mum, but she said the same thing.
Oh, very good.
All right, very so we've got Lee Hooky, Reese Wesser. No self-esteem for me. And we spoke about Peach. Peach was my third, of course, a sublime athlete. So we'll skip over Peach and we'll go to my fourth. This is the only one who didn't play for the Rabbitohs, but I couldn't leave him out. Preston Campbell. Just a great little player. You know, the epitome of heads-up football, you know. Presto would just – he'd bounce around like a pinball just off defenders and just, you know, do anything that came to mind, and it would just – 9 out of 10s be right. It'd be off the top of his head. And he was just a fantastic player to play around and a fantastic fella, Presto, and still doing good work in the community up there on the Gold Coast and beyond. But Presto, I'm pretty sure he won a Dally M Player of the Year one year when he was...
Yep, I think he did. Yeah, he did.
I mean, people forget just how good a player... To win the Dally M Player of the Year is no mean feat. Presto had some fantastic careers, and he was a little bit like Cody in that he didn't come to first grade straight away, and it didn't come, you know, in his late teens or early 20s. It was a bit later. He had to battle around at a few clubs and up at the Gold Coast, and then eventually Johnny Lang was the one that gave him a start, saw the potential, and he played some great footy at the Sharks. And then when Lange left the Sharks, he didn't play such great footy. Obviously, he didn't gel with the coaching staff or whatever was happening at the Sharks. So Lange brought him across to Penrith, and he just clicked into gear and was a big part of the reason why the Panthers won the grand final in 2003. So a Dally M winner, grand final winner, an instrumental part in that grand final win. So,
and also, he had to overcome, like, the size. He's only a little fella.
Tiny.
And had to be tough because, I mean, he wasn't – he'd run straight through the middle of the pack and he'd turn up anywhere. You know, it didn't worry him. He, you know, he was fearless.
Yes, he was fearless. People talk about people being all heart. He was the epitome of all heart on the football field and off the football field. He actually would just put his emotions right out there when he talks to kids and talk about his trials and tribulations and the great things that have happened to him. He would just give all of himself, and that's why I've always had a soft spot for Preston. He's just literally all heart on and off the field.
Yeah.
So my four are Lee Hooky, Reese Wesser, David Peachey, and Preston Campbell, four great Indigenous players.
Very good.
I like how they've all been from different eras.
Yes.
You know, which just goes to show how significant a part Indigenous players have had in their game.
Yes.
And who knows which players will stand up this week, because we know it means a lot to all the players, but particularly the Indigenous boys, to be highlighting their culture and wearing the special jerseys, and our guys are wearing special boots this week, and it really highlights their culture, and you never know which young Indigenous player will stand up and become the star.
Good point, Jez. I remember, I don't think it was last year, I think it was the year before, there was an Indigenous round where all of our tries were scored by Aboriginal players. I think it was 2019, was it, against the Dragons?
I think the only player that didn't score that day might have been Dane Gagai, but every other Indigenous player scored.
Yep, so they're obviously up for the game. Yeah. Obviously means a lot to the boys, and hope they can put in a blinder again this weekend.
Yeah. Very good. All right, that was a great chat there. We will be back in just a moment. Now, the Rabbitohs merchandise store, it's located down at the Heffron Park Tennis Centre on Bunurong Road in Maroubra. And if you can't make it down there, you can always shop online at shop.rabbitohs.com.au. But I think the shop's on the move soon, isn't it, Shannon?
It will be. We can't quite announce it yet, Jez. Yep. But, yeah, it's down there. So get down there.
So shut up, Jez.
Well, for anyone...
That was a polite...
just so you know, and obviously you haven't, for anyone that's listened to the latest episode of Rabbitohs Radio, they've let everyone know where it's going to be.
Right, okay. I just didn't want to confuse people, really, but that's okay. The cat's out the bag. Yes, it will be moving to South Juniors, but I'll still be there for another couple of weeks, and I encourage everybody to get down there. We've had a lot of stock just recently land back in. The Indigenous jerseys are now in stock, but they're selling fast. And we're limited edition. We got 1,000 of those, and they are selling quick. And so if you want one of those, I encourage you to get down to Heffron Park. And we also, speaking of Heffron Park, the new Heffron Centre, where we're building our new, the $58 million Heffron Centre, and our high performance centre is an integral part of that. That's recently been announced. The schematics and the designs of that have been announced for our members, and it's going to be our new HQ.
Yeah, it looked fantastic when we released that this week, and looking forward to seeing the bricks actually hitting the turf and are getting built. I think it's set to kick off in August, potentially, the build, ready for the 2023 preseason, which would be absolutely fantastic. So,
geez, that was quick.
What was that?
Well, just getting the high-performance centre built, you know, just come around like that.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, wasn't it? Yeah, we weren't talking about it back in 2010 or something.
Where's the Chinese restaurant down there?
I was playing SG Ball when he announced it.
Very good. Make sure you head down to Heffron Park, the tennis centre there, and visit the guys in the shop, or you can shop online at shop.rabbitohs.com.au. Now, there's obviously a lot of controversy at the moment about rule changes and rule interpretations and the way high tackles and crusher tackles and these sorts of things are being punished at the moment. We saw last night a couple of the Dirty Chooks players go down to the judiciary and predictably got rubbed out for long periods of time. Victor Radley looking at 5 weeks on the sideline. Angus Crichton a couple of weeks. It's cost them both their origin positions. And it's amazing how quickly this was implemented by the NRL and the effect that this rule change is having on the game. So I thought our next top four topic can be the top four rule changes that have had significant impacts on the game. So we might kick off with yours, Shannon.
Okay. The one that had a really big impact into the speed of the game was the interchange players, just allowing interchange players. Mm. They've played around with the numbers, but the fact that back in the day, everyone played reserve grade and you'd only go on in first grade if somebody got injured. There was no such thing as an interchange, but that certainly came in and I was very thankful. It meant I started to get to play some first grade because of interchange players and it meant that I didn't have to stay out there for 80 minutes. So I was also very thankful. It sort of helped make my not-so-illustrious career. But the interchange...
It's going to be very nasty. Yeah, there, by the way.
I'm just beating you to the punch. I want to take some sting out of the tail, hello. But the interchange was great for players like myself and you know, particularly the big boys, you know, allow them to get a blow. Some argue that it took the, you know, for the little guys, it took something away from them because they used to wait for the big guys to fatigue and then they would take on the line a little bit. Mm. But when the big blokes got fatigued and they interchanged, that sort of took a bit of that out of the game. But the interchange having interchange players, I think, revolutionised the game in that we could play at such a high speed and intensity for a long time. So I think that was a critical rule. Another rule change that I think was people sort of forget in all this furore about head knocks and whatnot, it happened not long ago when Dave Smith rubbed out punching.
Yeah.
You know, punching was a very similar thing and it was for the same reason. And, you know, everyone's jumping up and down now. Oh, this is terrible, it's going to ruin the game. They said the same thing about punching. You know, we used to laugh at the AFL with the jersey pulls and all that kind of stuff. We do that stuff now, but it had to stop. You know, I can honestly say I played lots of games and I don't remember too many without there being some punching. And but when it stopped, it was okay and it seemed natural after that. So
what the NRL was very good in that area in doing was that you went to the sin bin if you punched someone. That's exactly what they're doing now.
Yep.
I think it might have taken a month to get it out of the game.
Yep.
It'll get it out of the game.
Yes.
Mm. No one, you know, no one wants to be sitting on the sideline for 5 weeks like Radley is. I mean, we had Luttrell sit on the sideline for 4 weeks. I mean, they seem to change the rules. You know, they change it for him before they change it for everyone else while they look at it, you know.
Yep.
Yeah. But I like the way they've been consistent. Mm. I mean, they said, we're going to do it. We're going to do it.
Yep.
Now, they're concerned, obviously, about the HIA part of it and the concussions down the track. They're also concerned about participation levels. I mean, and participation levels is the biggest worry for the game at the moment.
Absolutely.
And it's because young parents, particularly mothers, don't want their kids playing in a sport where they can get so severely injured. I mean, let's face it. when we started playing rugby league, Shannon, we didn't know, you know, about head knocks and how they could affect you down the track. We're seeing evidence of it every day.
Yep.
I now see evidence of it every Wednesday morning. Oh,
I resemble that remark, Jess.
Yeah, I didn't know you played so many games, Jess. No, but seriously, it's real. It's real, and we want our game to continue. We're talking about all the different rule changes over the years that changed. Used to be unlimited tackles, came back to four tackles initially, now to six. Interchange. I'm not stealing thunder, but this is one of the big rule changes in the game that is going to help the longevity of the game.
Yep.
And ensure its existence. And we've got to go on with it. That's my opinion. And I say that now, you know, as I'm just I love rugby league, as you know. And it's not about South Sydney, it's not about the Roosters, it's not about the Eels, it's about rugby league supporters, and it's about the game continuing. And it's a good decision by the NRL, because they know, they see the problems if they keep it going as it is. And I applaud them for their actions overnight. They've supported the match review committee at the panel. And that's what needs to happen.
You weren't saying that 4 weeks ago.
No.
I wasn't, because I must say, they were different situations 4 weeks ago. They were really different situations.
You're right. It was a Rabbitohs player up there.
Yeah. But, yeah, seriously, it's – but now we accepted it. We didn't make a big fuss about it. We thought it was harsh on Latrell. But now at least they're consistent. We haven't seen players getting off for doing similar things.
You're right.
That's all we want.
Yeah.
That's all we want.
And I agree with you on every count there. One is, like the punching, the players will learn very quickly. It might take 2 or 3 weeks, but they'll adapt. Two, they're not really going to do it properly, and that's what they're doing. They're supporting it at the judiciary and those kind of things. So just like punching, in about 6 months, we're going to look back and say, yeah, I can't believe we allowed people to cop shoulder hits to the head. Our elbows have never been allowed to the head, but we're starting to protect the head more. People will just take it for granted like we do with punching now.
Because a shoulder to the head can, gives a lot more damage than a punch.
Yes.
Because of the force.
Hello, mate, I know what a shoulder to the head can do. I've got no neck, so I've got two shoulders to the head, and I'll tell you what, I've got severe brain damage, and I think that's from putting up with you. But anyway, let me go. So
there's been research done recently that bacon egg rolls can bring on early dementia.
Is that right?
Yeah.
I tell you, if you have one.
I'm in all sorts. Okay. So the two rule changes so far was the interchange players, the punching, and then I've got two rule changes in one here, because they both happened on the same day, the 28th of March 1971, just over 50 years ago. And the first one was the field goal going from 2 points to 1 point. We all know, as Rabbitohs, we all know the reasons behind that. Eric Sims was just kicking them from everywhere and we were winning. That was during our sort of 67 to 71, where we played in five grand finals and won four of them. So at the end of that, after being in five grand finals and Eric kicking us to all that success, the NRL, or the New South Wales Rugby League as it was then, changed 2 points to 1 point. And that was on the 28th of March 1971. So that was a really, really big rule change. That certainly affected our club. Some may say was for the benefit of the game, but it certainly was detrimental to our club having such a great kicker in Eric Sims.
We still went on and won a couple more comps, though.
We did. Well, no.
I'm sure.
71. No, we didn't.
1970, it was reduced.
I thought it was the 28th of March, 1971.
Not according to my research.
Well, there you go. Oh, you know what?
Can you two take this outside, please? It's getting a bit heated here.
You know what?
I don't trust either of you. That's the problem.
In both the factual count and the potential fight, I've got my money on Jess. Yeah.
I was going to say, you must have looked at Wikipedia after me when I then changed Wikipedia to say the wrong date, just in case it tripped you
I'll
up.
I'll back you. So, anyway, the field goal certainly won. Yes. And then moving from four tackles to six tackles is actually a big one, because I think it allowed teams to attack a bit more, not having to just, play out field and kick and become field about field position, and the kicking duels and all that kind of stuff. It was actually able to use the ball a bit more because we had those two extra tackles. And Those rule changes, I believe, happened on the same date, whether 70, 71 or
You're 70. Probably right. You're probably right.
But they happened on the same time. And the two transformational changes that benefited the game. And, you know, this theme came about because of the controversial rule change coming in now. And I'm hoping that just like those two rule changes, this one is for the benefit of the game. So, as I like to do, I'll summarise again. Interchange players punching the field goal from 2 points to one and four tackles to six are my four rule changes.
Well, one of the ones I had on my list just on that, the tackles, I actually had the step before where it became limited tackles.
Ah, yeah.
So it was unlimited tackles, and then the Dragons won 11 comp straight. They changed it to the four tackle rule and their run stopped because they just used to dominate possession and never let the other team have the ball. That's how they won
years straight. What the great Dragons and Rabbitoh teams of the years used to do. If the other team kicked off, they would kick the ball back to them and bash them.
Yes.
So they want them to have the ball for the first five and just rip into them. And then when they got the ball, they'd knock the wind out of them and then no one could handle them.
Yes.
That's how they used to do it.
Yeah. So it greatly affected the Dragons. It ended their run of 11 premierships. That changed the limited tackle rule.
Yes.
So what did you have, Ella?
Oh, look, all of those. I mean, there's been some great changes in the game, but the greatest one for me recently is the fact that the corner post is no longer a part of
the field. That as one of mine too.
I mean, it has just created so much, you know, so many highlights on you know, out of games. Some of the, you know, the acrobatics and that wingers do now, you know. It's a real skill to be able to score in that corner. And the fact that you can hit the corner post now makes for better try.
Yeah. That was 11 years ago, you know.
Oh, I didn't know it was that long ago. Yeah,
2010 that came in.
Is that right?
It was driven by Andrew Voss. He was on it for many years. His reasoning is that how can you have something like that indicating where the sideline is or the in-goal area is, that if someone gets tackled on it, it sits on an angle. It often lies on the ground.
Yep.
And there's no consistency as to where that pole stands to indicate that that's the corner post line and you can't touch it. So when blokes are getting tackled on and it's lying on the ground, blokes were flying over where the corner post should have been.
Yes.
And it wasn't a consistency in the rules. And the NRL eventually said, yep, makes sense. Let's take it out and look at the change it's made for winners.
It stops the kids running on the field after the game.
Also keeps Peters of Kensington very happy.
I was going to say.
That's going to take me to one thing I think that the NRL should bring. I've spoken about this many times before.
Yes. Hello. Could I just preface to say a nice word about our sponsors at Garlo Pies, because I know what Ella's about to say. And thank you, Garlo, for all your support. Now just block your ears for a second, please.
Now, one of the significant parts of our game and excitement is the 40-20. And now the
24.
Okay, so
we had Dean Hawkins kicked one on the weekend.
Yeah, he did. It was a great effort. But the biggest problem our game has is that it's hard to decide if it actually if it goes just across the junction of the sideline and the 20, the touch judges are too far back to actually see.
Mm.
What I've proposed before.
You suggesting we have 12 touch judges on each sideline?
Suggesting you keep your mouth shut for a little bit longer, Jess.
If you know what's good for you.
I'm suggesting that we have a post there, similar to the corner post, that goes up probably about 6 foot high, right? So that signifies that is the area, the junction of the 20-metre line and the sideline.
Yep.
Now, if the ball comes in front of it, it's obviously not a 40-20.
Yep.
If the ball goes behind it, it's a 40-20. And if it hits it, it's a 40-20.
Yep.
Okay. Now, by having that there, you go to the technology and the bunker and that, you can see which side the ball goes of that. All right. Now, if it hits it, it should light up like the bales do in T20 cricket. Okay. Just give something for the crowd to get more involved in as well. Now, 40-20, 4-20 pies could sponsor it. sorry, Gala. But it doesn't even have to be that. But I just think it'd be a great innovation for the game to bring that in. And, you know, you get more players going to try to do it as well.
Garlo could do some ambush marketing and invent a 40 and 20 pie. brought to you by Garlo's Pies. Yes.
That's right.
Garlo's already got the sponsorship sold before the rules come in. That's why I've been trying to smother it and crush it, Garlo. I got your back, Sean. Don't worry about it, my man.
No, but, you know, I reckon that would revolutionise the game as well and get players more active to try and be kicking it, get the crowd involved and, you know. Because these innovations in the game, you know when your team kicks a 40. Well, we saw it in the preliminary final last year. We missed by that much from where Renault's foot was.
Yeah.
You know, that would have been a significant change in that game.
Yep. But I like it, Ella.
Yeah. The other rule change, we'll talk about the number of tackles. The other one that's helped our game now with the interchange in that is the 10-metre rule.
Yep.
We used to have 5-metre rule back in the day and – you know, the game was different then.
Mm.
You know, that started when there was unlimited tackles.
Mm.
So, you know, teams could have the ball for 10 minutes back in those days. So if players were running back 10 metres, it would just be diabolical.
Yeah.
But that's changed the game. How it's changed the game, though, obviously it's separated the teams. But by giving that extra distance, it's made defences have to become more accountable because having that extra distance just makes it too easy to attack if you're not defending properly.
Yeah.
So that was significant for the game in changes.
Yeah.
So that's just adding to the ones you had there, Shannon.
I only had one additional one on that, and it's Golden Point.
Oh,
it was experimented with in Super League in 97, and then it was introduced to the NRL in 2003. I love Golden Point. I know a lot of people don't like it, but I love it. I think it adds so much excitement to the game, and we've had good results and bad results out of Golden Point, but it just the tension in the stadium when it's Golden Point, and people say it's a field goal shootout, but if scores are locked at 18-all, it's a field goal shootout for the last 5 minutes of a regular time as well.
I agree with it in the normal home and away series.
Mm.
In playoff games, I think it should be extra time and a war of attrition.
Yeah, well, that's
my opinion.
Yeah. That's fair. I don't think you should. Even extra time. I just love the fact that there's that extra period of time where you know there's going to be a winner.
Yeah, yes.
You know, there's you just someone's going to score, and it's not in our records. We've had 4 draws, but we've played 17 Golden Point games.
Yep.
So it's not often that it does end up in a draw after that period of time, but.
How many of those 17 did we ever win out of?
That's a good point.
7.
1-7, drawn 4.
Lost 6.
Yes.
Yeah. So we've had mixed results with it. But I just remember some of the, like, one of the great wins and one of Willie Peters' greatest moments was when we beat the Tigers in Golden Point. He'd had about 12 field goal shots. He finally got the 13th one over. And it was all because the late, great Kevy Freeman, who was Reggie Rabbit at one stage, he was the timekeeper that day. And Kevy liked a beer, and we all thought that maybe he'd had a couple before
he'd had
that
12
game.
12 schooners by then.
And Golden Point was always 2 periods of 5 minutes, and Kevy just said, bugger that, we're just going to play 10. And so the game just rolled on, and after about 8 minutes, everyone's like, where's this halftime siren? Where are you, Kevy? Why haven't you pressed the button? And Willie just kept having shots at field goal. He eventually got one over, and we won the game.
Good on him. Good on him.
So, yeah, that was the only extra one that that I had there. Going back to that, the 1-point field goal, there was also the increase in points for tries too, from 3 to 4.
Yeah.
And I think it's something that, and I know you don't like talking about this sport, LO, but rugby union could really learn from. They lifted their tries from 4 to 5.
All right, we'll stop it there, Jess. We don't want to give them any ideas.
But their field goals and penalty goals are still worth 3, which is more than a try. So really, rugby union's played on 50 metres of the field, and if you get within reach of a penalty goal or a field goal, they're going to take it.
Yeah.
So it's something that they could learn from, reducing the value of those points, but as usual, we're ahead of the game.
Yeah.
So.
Yes. No, you're right there, Jeff.
So, yeah. So, anyway, some good rule changes to reflect upon there, and who knows what the next one.
Yeah, bring it on.
That might
I think we went through all our rule changes there. They've made differences to the game as a spectacle.
Yeah.
The rule change has been made 2 weeks ago. Was made a difference to the game to protect players from each other.
Yeah.
And I think that's where it's such a significant thing. And I think we'll look back, in 10, 20 years and say, thank God that they did that then. And we'll see the numbers in our game start to increase. Let's hope so anyway.
Yeah, no, good point. Righto, we'll be back in just a moment. Now, the Rabbitohs are back with home games for season 2021, which means you can get your corporate hospitality and game day experiences from the Rabbitohs. And, of course, we're back out at Stadium Australia this Saturday night for the Indigenous round against the Eels. And there's a few games coming up at Stadium Australia over the next couple of months. So, Shannon, it's perfect time to be able to jump in and have a night out with your mates or entertain some business clients.
Absolutely. It's fantastic for both of those things, Jez. And well, even just the hardcore supporters get down and have some of those inner sanctum experiences. Now that the COVID restrictions are starting to ease across the NRL, you know, we've often got corporate guests down watching the team warm up, meeting with players, meeting with injured players in their own suites. All of those kind of things are available if you work with the Rabbitohs and take on some of our corporate hospitality.
Yeah, very good. So make sure you jump on corporate.rabbitohs.com.au to check out all the options there. Now, our trivia question from last week was, playing out in Dubbo, how many first grade games did Les Davidson play for South Sydney? Now, the hint was that he played eight seasons with us between 1983 and 1990. Of course, he had the time at the Sharks, but we're not worried about his time at the Sharks, so we're only worried about his time at the Rabbitohs.
You can tell him that, Jez.
Yeah.
I had him in the corporate room out there and I was having a few heckles with him and I saw his eyes starting to squint a little bit and I thought, I better ease up here.
Well, what's your guess?
122.
Oh.
I'm going with Shannon.
Again, 2 weeks in a row.
Because I said it with confidence. Well, you're gravely mistaken, Ella.
It was 103 first grade games. He scored 5 tries for 20 points with the Rabbitohs. It's actually part of 152 grade games with the club, so he did play a little bit of lower grades, but the Dubbo boy did good for the Rabbitohs, 103 first grade games.
Yeah, he did, and as I said in one of the podcasts before, Les came down as just this wiry young guy, tall guy, and he was never massive, Les, you know, as we discussed. So, you know, he came through the grades, through the third grade, then second grade, and then hit the scene in first grade. He didn't play many second grade games after that.
Yeah, and obviously I had the pleasure of interviewing him out at Dubbo in one of the corporate rooms, and I was talking to him about his highlights at the Rabbitohs and going on and playing for New South Wales and Australia. I played with Les actually myself at the Sharks, but, you know, the highlights are going on and playing with New South Wales and Australia and all, you know, these great experiences. And I was asking him over the years, I said, Les, who's out of everyone, who's the best player you've played with? And why was I? And that was the last question I got to ask you, mate. But thanks for making the effort to come out.
Very good. Yeah, it was good to see Dave out there. And as we said, Peach and Kyle Turner and Terry Fahey was there. There were a whole heap of ex-players out there, so it was good to see them all. Now, I've come up with a very special trivia question for this week with us playing Parramatta. Now, back in 1989, the South Sydney Rabbitohs took on the Parramatta Eels out at Parramatta Stadium, and then this happened.
Sterling, switch of play. Finds Erickson with a great pass on the inside. Oh, what a hit. Great defence from Ellison. Let's have a look at that hit. That was mighty by Ellison. Watch this. Here he comes, Erickson. Bang, up he goes, and down he goes, and where he stops, nobody knows. What a beauty.
Now, if anyone wants to look that up on YouTube, I think it's actually Mavo's YouTube channel. It's Botany09, and he's got a whole heap of old games on there. It's back from 89 when the Rabbitohs played at Parramatta Stadium. Ello resembled something more like The Rock or Stone Cold Steve Austin, a big crossbody shot on Michael Erickson as he's made a break. Ello playing at fullback. An unusual position for him. I haven't seen...
He was playing, to be fair, he was playing lock, but he was just bludging back there.
Well, it resembled something like, you know, the famous footage of Harrigan and Carroll coming together and bodies flying in the two different directions. That's what it resembled. It was absolutely phenomenal. We watched it quite a few times when Ello's coming to my office and said, let's get that on YouTube. Show me that on YouTube.
talk about
I can't remember that. Oh, yeah. I can't remember that, Jess.
Talk about LO's big hits. Maybe you've had too many head knocks. Let's turn it up.
Anyway.
I'd have got 12 weeks in today's game for Jess.
You would have.
I don't think I would have, actually. I don't think I made contact.
No, I think
with
you got it. You got him below the head. Yeah. You knocked him around.
LO was more likely to throw his handbag at him. Turn it up. LO doing big hits.
Anyway, keeping in mind LO was playing fullback, the question I ask you is, what number jersey was LO wearing that day? Okay. Not usually a fullback, and we remember that back in the day, jerseys were numbered 1 to 13, and then in reserve grade, the fullback would be 14, and it would go down to 26, and then in the under President's Cup or whatever, they'd be the next lot of numbers. So the guys on the bench would have ridiculous numbers, number 82 or something on their back. So you have to think about what number he might have seen. If you look it up on YouTube, it's quite clear because Ello's the man standing and Ericsson's the one that's half buried in the turf at Parramatta Stadium. But it's one of the great hits. So look that up on YouTube and you'll get the answer to the trivia question for next week.
It's not one of the great Ello hits. It's the great hello. It's the only.
I'd have had a few more if I was playing against you.
He's like Millie Vanilli. He's had one hit.
I'm actually going to.
That should be his nickname, Millie Vanilli.
I'm going to apply for it to become one of those non-fungible video cards that you collect. It's great footage. I love it.
Listen,
anyway,
can we get a bit of footage up here next week before we go to the air right.
There he is asking to watch it again.
Yes. Now I want to see what number I had on, Jess.
If it's a reserve grade number, like 42 or something. I thought it was the size of the jersey.
Very good. We'll be back. Now, if you're looking for your next epic holiday, maybe a long weekend with your mates, or you want to get to the next game, we've said it before, it's time to What If It. What If has great deals on accommodation, flights, car hire and more. Plus, they're the official travel partner of the South Sydney Rabbitohs, so if you head to whatif.com/Rabbitohs and use the promo code Rabbitohs15, you can save 15% on select hotels. So conditions apply with that, but there was almost 11,000 people in Dubbo on the weekend, and I'm sure a lot of the South members and supporters that travelled out there from Sydney and other areas would have jumped on What If to secure their flights and accommodation.
I'm sure they did, Jez, as did I. You got the 15% discount in Dubbo, and I'll be using that discount as well for our game up in Brisbane in about a month or so. Fantastic, the guys from What If, in terms of looking after our members with those great discounts and looking after our pathway sides. In fact, our pathway side, our New South Wales Cup side, flew out there on a charter plane to be out there for the game, and they're sponsored by What If, and it's that kind of sponsorship that allows us to look after our pathways players so well. So we thank What If for looking after not only our members in terms of great prices and discounts and convenient ways to book your travel, but also we thank What If and Daniel Finch and the great team there for their support of our pathways teams.
Probably a good time just to mention how, you know, our What If sponsored teams are going. That, like, the Penrith are undefeated in both grades on the weekend. Second grade lost on the bell with a penalty goal. And our Jersey Fleet team, under-21s, with the inclusion of some of our SG ball players, are just going through the roof.
I mean, they won by 30 points.
Yeah, they just bashed Penrith out of the game. And there's some great skill coming through. There's some players that we've acknowledged with internally that we think are going to go on and be, you know, have a long career at the Rabbitohs. And, you know, we thank What If for helping us out to bring these guys through.
Indeed. I remember under 20 squad, or under 21 squad, winning in 2019 out there at Bankwest Stadium, and the Jersey Fleet side it was, and being with Daniel Finch in that, from What If, in the dressing room after the game, and he said it was one of the best experiences he's had, and sounds like he's a good chance of experiencing that again this year with this year's Jersey Fleet side.
We've got, you know, Lockie Ilias is playing half back there. We've got David Mulally's leading the pack four. We've got some, you know, not just naming them. We got some young kids like Talis Duncan's just come in from the SG ball. Josiah Carapani, he's come in. He's going to be a development player for us next year. Peter Mamazoulis, he's there with us as well. And just, you know, I've probably missed one or two there, but, you know, they're really putting it together well. And it's the enthusiasm, and they're playing for the jersey, which is what I love.
And we even got a smile out of their coach, Joe O'Callaghan, after the game.
Oh, did we?
Yeah, I took the photo, remember, and sent it around on WhatsApp.
I think it was
for
win.
Prosperity.
I think it was win.
It was funny. I went up to him and I said, I've been asked to get a photo of you smiling, and he didn't show me any teeth. Gave me a half grin, and I took the photo, and he's gone, now who asked for that?
Yeah, funny. I was in the dressing room. Sorry, not the dressing room. In close quarters to the Joe during the game, the Jersey Flag game at Redfern, the Ironmark High Performance Centre at Redfern recently, and Joe was up there coaching from there, and he's very, very intense, isn't he? One stage he was kicking chairs and he was screaming abuse, and that was just at me. So it was
he's asked you to sit down because he couldn't see.
I knew I shouldn't have ate his pie. I just said, Joe, sorry, mate. I thought it was mine.
Oh, very good. Very good. So jump on whatif.com/Rabbitohs. Use that promo code Rabbitohs15. What if? It's Aussie for travel. It's time for Shannon's joke of the week. Do the kids need to cover their ears for this one, mate?
Probably, actually, probably. So I encourage you, if you're in the car and you got it on and the kids are in the back seat, block the kids' ears or just stop the...
press pause.
Yes, indeed. Speaking of pause, it involves a dog. great segue, Jess.
That's great. Very good. Very good.
It just reminds me of the time I was just at Redfern Park, actually, just outside the Oval, and I just saw these two winos sitting on a park bench and sharing... bottle of something, and you know, they're just sitting there not talking much to each other, and I was just watching a little bit intrigued, and then this little mangy flea bitten dog just sits down right in front of them, cocks its leg, starts licking itself, licking its genitalia and licking itself all over.
Oh dear.
Two winos just sitting there watching this perplexed. Other one leans into the other one. I was trying to hear what he said, that looks like fun. I wish I could do that. And the other one said, you could, but he'd probably bite you.
Oh, very good. Very good, very good.
The things you see at Redfern.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. Hello, we'll be back to you next week for the joke of the week. So we look forward to that. Well, thanks again for listening, everyone. Make sure you send in your topic suggestions to us on Twitter or at rabbitohs.com.au/podcast. Write us a review or give us a 5-star rating if you can, and make sure you subscribe or follow us on those podcast apps wherever you are getting your podcasts and listening to us today. And don't forget to tune in to our other podcasts on the Rabbitohs Podcast Network, particularly the Rabbitohs Radio Boys. They're doing a great job. They actually interviewed Luke Carroll this week when we couldn't interview him last week.
He's dead to me, Jez. Chica, if you're listening, you're dead to me. Supposed to be in with us and you join the other guys, but fortunately they're all part of the same podcast network, and as long as you continue to do your work exclusively with the Rabbitohs, we'll be fine.
Yeah, that's right. Yes, he'll be our on-field grand announcer this week. Let's hope he does as good a job as the bloke that normally does it. So
Yes.
you've been sacked, have you?
I'm moving upstairs into the level 5 studio, so I'll just be a voice. I won't be out on the field this week.
Oh, is that right?
So I'll be announcing scores and reading all the Shannon's ads for 3 grades of footy, and Luke will be down there running the show down on the field. Being Indigenous round, we felt it was appropriate that he got down there and helped represent the Indigenous and Torres Strait Islander people this week. And
yeah, he's a passionate Rabbitohs through and through his whole life, Chica, and loves the Rabbitohs. He's proud of his Indigenous culture, and I can't think of a better guy to be our ground announcer, and I can't think of a better guy to replace Jez. In fact, I can think of 6 other billion better guys to replace Jez, but we'll do with Chica this week, eh?
I was going to say, it's a really tough gig down there, and with everything you do, I hope he gets a chance to rehearse.
Yes.
somewhere before he does the Rabbitohs, before he does the main event of the Rabbitohs.
One thing I know, he'll be a lot precious than the usual talent down there. You know, he won't have all these big riders on it, you know, 2 cans of Coke. It has to be sugar free, and
Zero,
I need silence,
Coke
please.
Zero.
And he's doing the vocal testing beforehand. It's
la,
just
la, la, la,
it's
la,
obscene.
La.
It is absolutely obscene.
Jez, we need to have a yarn to you too, mate. I think you have a misconception that you think it's only for Indigenous round.
We just want to let you do it slowly, mate.
We'll see. Yeah, that's okay.
Very good. Very good.
So jump onto Rabbitohs Radio. Listen to Chaps and Mavo and Brownie as they take you through the round of footy. They talk about NRL news. They've got their Remembering a Rabbitohs segment. It's a great show. Well worth a listen. We've got our weekly player and coach interviews that go on there, and also the audio version of the Rabbitohs Insider. And thank you again for joining us, gents. Episode 15 next week.
Yeah, and I'm really looking forward to next week with Ella reading the ad reads and the intros, and that's gonna be fantastic.
Will I give him the roadcaster? Will I give him the steering wheel?
He can't turn on his phone. What chance has he got of using the roadcaster? God help us.
You might have to zoom in next week because I won't be in town next week. What? I've got a few little things I have to do.
On the bye week.
Yeah, have they got Zoom at South Coogee Bowling Club? Does the Wi-Fi worker in the TAB section over there?
He's going to do a Matt Damon. Did you see the Matt Damon?
I did, yes.
Did an interview with the Today Show in the US from a tab up at Byron Bay. Yeah.
Copying yellow again. We're leaders again in the field.
Well, we'll organise that. We'll get the Zoom sorted out. Zoom can do anything. Another proud sponsor of the mighty Rabbitohs. So we'll be back next week in some way, shape or form for the Rabbitohs Top 4 podcast, powered by Audio Technica and, as usual, proudly presented by What If. We will see you then.
Thanks for listening to the Rabbitohs Top 4 podcast, powered by Audio Technica and proudly presented by What If, official travel and pathways partner of the South Sydney Rabbitohs. Support the club and visit whatif.com/Rabbitohs to book your next trip. Don't forget to use the code Rabbitohs15 to get 15% off select hotels. Conditions apply. What If? It's Aussie for travel. Please leave us a 5-star rating and subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. Up the Rabbitohs.